So this is what is called, you know, diffraction of radio waves. Okay, so that is the reason why you are able to get this transmission. Another way of understanding this is, suppose if somebody is talking in the other room, right? If the door was open, will you be able to hear it? Right? The reason for that is the sound waves are able to diffract or bend around the corners. Okay? So the sound waves wavelength is somewhere in the order of this obstacle, which is the window or the door opening. Right? So because of that, you are able to hear it. But if somebody switches on the light over there, will you be able to see it from here? No, right? Unless you are in the line of sight, you cannot see it, right? Which means the light is not able to bend around. Are you following what I am saying? So that means if the obstacle is in the order of the lambda, right? So radio waves, I am talking about something in the order of few kilometers, 1 meter to. So radio waves, lambda is few meters to few kilometers. It can be anywhere here. And bend around the buildings or even small mountains. Okay, so this is illustrated here. So visible light, say lambda, I told you it's somewhere around 400 to 700 nanometers approximately. Can bend around small apertures, very small apertures, say 0.1 millimeter. So that's what we have been doing here, right? Can you just put it in the back? So as I told you, the diffraction pattern is slightly different from the interference pattern. So any idea how it is different? You have seen this many times now. Okay, what about the other one? Is it working? Okay. So this is like a single slit, right? So I told you, if it is pretty big, right, you are not going to see any pattern at all. You see just a single dot, you are not going to see anything. But as I make it smaller and smaller, right, so let's say I am making it, so some, right now maybe it's in the order of say 1 millimeter or something. So let's try it. So you can see slight horizontal line. If I make it even more smaller, right? Can you see that pattern? So you can see the maxima and minimas clearly. So what is the difference between the previous one which you saw in the interference and this one? This is single slit, but I am asking about in the pattern there is something different. So let's see if I can show you the one also. So So I think this is a double slit, right? So this is like this, and then I can show you the single slit here, right? It's the same. Intensity of central one is kind of very high compared to the side ones, right? The secondary ones are very, very weak, right? Whereas in the double slit, right? So this is more like an interference pattern when you have double slit, right? Of course, the central is still bright, but you can see the other ones are not that weak. So maybe if you see the, as I told you, if the small d decreases, what happens to the beta? Beta increases, right? So you saw this other day, right? You can see the central bright and the other secondaries are not that much different. Do you agree? Right? It's almost the same. Or of course, I can see a difference. The center one is very bright, but the others are not that bright. But that is not the case with the single slit. So if I use a single slit, you see a totally different pattern here. You see the central one is very, very bright, the other ones are very, very dull. Do you agree? Okay. So that is the important difference between interference pattern and single slit diffraction pattern. Okay. So even though it looks like almost the same, it's not the same thing. So there are some differences. Let's go back to the theory and then come back if we want to see something more. We'll come back to it. So the diffraction pattern is going to be slightly different. So let me draw it here. So interference was, maybe I'll erase this and we'll talk about it. So we cannot show the light in the diagram, right? So the only way to show that is using a intensity graph, right? So in the case of interference, we showed something like this. Meaning, this is my central one, n is equal to 0, this is n is equal to 1, this is n is equal to 2, right? So, anybody remember the formula here? It is lambda d by d, right? So, lambda d by d. So, if it is n, if it is 1, it will be 1 here. If it is 2, it will be 2 lambda d by d, right? That is your fringe width location. This one, something like that, okay? The theta value would be, the capital D will be gone, right? So go back and see. So we'll be seeing something like this. So this is your fringe location. This is your angular location. Yeah. So what can you say about this part? So we have been talking about the maxima. Again, I am talking about interference and not talking about diffraction now. What about this point? This is 1, this is 2. So that means this must be 1.5 dot fringe, right? So it will be 3 by 2. So 3 by 2 lambda d by d, right? This would be 1 by 2 lambda d by d. The same thing, you know, remove the capital D and you will get the angular location. So 1 by 2 lambda by d, 3 by 2 lambda by d, right? So I am sure you must have studied this properly. So this is what we showed for interference pattern. Okay. Interference pattern. But for diffraction pattern, right? So as I was showing you in the laser light, so instead of showing it like this, we'll be showing slightly differently. So instead of like this, it'll be like this, be like this. What does that tell you? The central bright fringe is pretty bright, whereas the other ones are not that bright. Okay, and the width is also pretty big for the central bright fringe. I don't know if you noticed it. So the central bright fringe will be having a bigger width compared to. So here it was pretty much the same everywhere, right? All the dots were showing up almost the same size, right? All the red dots. Whereas here, if you had seen, it's slightly bigger. So it should be something like this. Yeah, double the size. So this is the diffraction pattern. So the intensity will be very low compared to the first one. So take it down. Diffraction pattern will be having intensity of secondary maxima. Secondary maximas will be very low compared to the central bright fringe. Okay, that's one point you have to know. The second one is second one, will come back to it later. So it's something to do with the width of this, two times this. Yeah.
This part will keep moving forward.
Diffraction depends again upon the size of the obstacle, right? So if it is very very small obstacle, then that will be a bending around, otherwise you will not see them. So in the case of the hill, the radio waves were able to bend around, whereas the light is not going to bend around, right? Maybe it can do some scattering, but it cannot bend around. So it depends upon the obstacle size. So if it's somewhere in the order of wavelength, then it will bend around. Okay. So this is just a revision, right? So we already studied this interference pattern. So are you understanding the main difference between the interference and diffraction patterns? Yeah. So now let's try to understand the little more differences, how the fringe location and the fringe width, all these things, you know, comes here in the diffraction pattern. So unlike the interference, right, you don't have a derivation here, but then there is some theoretical explanation given in the book. So if I have the slit from here to here, let's say this is my slit, or let me make it little more bigger. So suppose if I say that I have a light coming from this point and then it's going, I'm going here. So, since you already seen the interference pattern, right, interference derivations, I hope you understand what I'm talking about. So, some wave from here is going here and some wave from here is going here, right? So, in the diffraction pattern, what happens is, this is the slit width. So, instead of D, we are going to call it as B. Let's call it as B or A, whatever you want, you can call it, okay? That is not called as D because D is usually used for interference, the slit separation, right? The slit separation is D, whereas here we are talking about the slit width. So, slit width is taken as B or A, whatever it is. So, that means according to Huygens principle, right? So, when the light comes over here, right? So, when the light comes over here, according to Huygens principle, what is Huygens' first principle? Each point acts as a secondary source. So, that means, so the theory here is, this is going to send out some waves like this. This is going to send out the waves like this. This is going to send out the waves like this. This is going to, so every point acts as a secondary source. That means, just like what you saw in the interference, right? So, these things are going to interfere at some point, and then there will be some constructive and some destructive interference, right? You know, you already know what is constructive and destructive interference, right? So, if it is in phase, then it is constructive, right? Out of phase means it will be destructive. So, it's almost the same concept, but it's a little more complicated, right? So, if you are going to take physics in college, we'll be studying more about this as optics will be coming as a separate topic. But right now, they are given a simple explanation for this. So, what they have done is, so if I divide this into two parts, right, let's say this is B by 2, this is B by 2. So, if I divide this entire slit into, right, B by 2 and B by 2, two parts, right. So, imagine that I have one source here called 1. And the corresponding source here is called as 1 dash. So, if I had 2 here, there will be a corresponding source here called 2 dash. Okay. And suppose if my path difference between this and this, right? So, you know that we already talked about this. So, this is my path difference, right? So, from here to here, let's assume that it's almost the same distance, which means this is not going to make any difference. Only difference will be caused by this path difference, right? So, this is what is called path difference. So, if this is B and if this is theta, right? So, this will be B sine theta. Do you agree? So, this entire thing will be B sine theta. And if I draw a small line here, right? So, based on similar triangles, if this is B sin theta, what can you say about this length? This is half. That means this should also be half of this one, right? Similar triangles, right? So, the corresponding sides will be proportional, right? So, everyone following that, this entire triangle is one triangle and this is a smaller triangle. So, this is B by 2 of this. So, the B is a full length and B by 2 is this half length. So, if this is a full length, then this should be half of it, similar triangles. So, that means if this is B sin theta, this will be B sin theta by 2. So, suppose if this path difference is equal to n lambda, right? So, what did we say in interference? We said it would lead to constructive interference, right? Because 1 lambda is one full wave, which means it will be in phase, right? So, half wave would be out of phase. So, that means it will be, however, in this case, what happens is we are talking about this point and this point. But look at this. So, we are talking about this one and this one. So the path difference between this and this is actually only b sin theta by 2, not b sin theta. Okay. So in that case, if I say this is going to give you, okay, let's see, b sin theta by 2 is going to give me lambda by 2. So please listen carefully, okay, this is a bit confusing. So if I say that b sin theta is equal to n lambda, right? So let's assume that it is coming around n lambda, right? So this is, we are taking only one case. Similarly, you have 2n plus 1 lambda by 2 or 2n minus 1 lambda by 2, right? That is also we will be studying later. So right now we are considering only this one. So this is a case, right? So if this is n lambda, what can you say about this one? N lambda by 2, half of it. So that means this will be equal to n lambda by 2. So that means the lambda by 2, right, as such it is, the path difference between this and this is actually n lambda by 2. So in usual case, in the interference, what we would say is, in that case the source would be between here and here. Okay, so carefully understand, this is a bit confusing. So in the case of interference, we said there is one source here and one source here, and the path difference was n lambda, and in that case we said it is constructive interference. Okay, now we are saying there is one source here and one source here, right? The path difference here is actually n lambda by 2. If this is the case here, then this will be n lambda by 2. So lambda by 2, will it give you constructive or destructive? Destructive, right? So the lambda by 2 will give you a destructive interference, because it's only the half the wave. So I told you it's something like this. So if you have one wave like this, and if you send only another wave, so this is one wave, this is another wave. So if these two points are coinciding at the same location, this is pushing it up, this is pushing it down, which means they will destructively interfere. And that's the meaning which you are talking about here. Even though we are not showing the waves, you have to assume that there is some waves going here. Then that's what we are trying to talk about. So in this case, what will happen is 1 and 1 dash will destructively interfere. Okay, so carefully listen. If I say 1 and 1 dash will destructively interfere, I can say the same thing can be extended for all the other points. So I can say 2 and 2 dash will also have the same effect, 3 and 3 dash will also have the same effect. So that is why we call it as infinite source. So we can have infinite sources here. So that means the path difference A theta B theta by, so let's see what is that they are using in your textbook. Are they using A or B? Anybody know it? A? Okay. So I think in that case, let's follow the same thing like your book. so that you don't get confused when you're reading the book. Okay. So that means I will say that A sine theta by 2 is equal to n lambda by 2 from here. And 2 cancels. And if theta is very small, theta is very small, sine theta is equal to theta. So that means I can say A theta is equal to n lambda. So theta is equal to n lambda by A. So this is the explanation given for destructive interference for the dark fringe. So let's call this as dark fringe or dark fringe. So if they ask you to explain how the dark fringes are formed in diffraction pattern, this is what you are supposed to explain. Okay. So you have to say that you split this into half, and then you say this is, if I take this as A sine theta, because this is theta, this is A sine theta is equal to n lambda, means usually you would think that it is constructive, but then it's not constructive here, because this is A sine theta by 2, this is n lambda by 2, so 2 cancels, so A sine theta is equal to n lambda looks like it's actually a destructive interference, not a constructive interference. Okay. So this is another main difference between interference and diffraction pattern. Okay. The formula is slightly different. So A is slit width, right? So what can you say about the theta? So what is theta? Theta is how much the light is kind of going like this. Right, that is what is theta, right? So if the A is bigger, what happens to theta? Theta becomes smaller, which means the light is not going like this, it's almost going in the straight line. When the theta is smaller, what happens to theta? Sorry, if A is smaller, theta becomes bigger, which means as we reduce the slit width, right, the theta increases. Are you following? So that's the explanation given for why the slit width should be comparable to lambda. Okay, so take it down. So you may get a question, why slit width should be comparable to lambda for diffraction pattern. So the answer you are supposed to write is as, so write this formula, n lambda by A. Remember, it's very similar to your interference formula, right? Only thing there you had seen this in constructive, right? So here it is in destructive. So as A decreases, theta increases. Everyone following this? So theta increases means what? You will see more light pushed this way, which means it is what is called diffraction, right? If all the light is focused in one single point without going this way, then you can say there is no diffraction. So A smaller means theta increases, so more diffraction. As A increases, theta decreases, so less or no diffraction. Been following this? So I've given you the topic also, so that's what you are supposed to write if they ask you to explain dark fringe formation in a diffraction pattern. So anybody having doubts? I know it's not an easy topic here, okay, so it takes some time for you to understand what we are talking about. So let me repeat one more time. If I take this as n lambda, right, then this should be n lambda by 2. That's all I'm saying. Very simple, right? You know from similar triangles. That means if I say this is n lambda by 2, if I have one source here, right? So if I have a wave going like this, if it is lambda by 2, it is not going to produce constructive, it's going to be destructive. That's all I'm saying. But then if you see this point, right, if you see the math here, 2 cancels and it becomes like a theta is equal to n lambda, which looks like your interference constructive pattern. Is that clear? Any doubts? Okay, so that's the explanation you are supposed to give for dark fringe. So now let's talk about bright fringe. So they may ask you how to explain the bright fringe. So the bright fringe is somewhat straightforward, nothing very confusing. Why? Because the path difference will be? So you have a single slit here, and you have a bright fringe here. So one source from here goes like this, one source goes from here. Yeah. So let's do the same thing. So this is my A slit width. This is my A by 2. Let's say this is 1, this is 1 dash. This is 2, 2 dash. Are you following what I mean by that? It's just some small sources, point sources. So according to Huygens' principle, we said that each point will act as a secondary source. So that means you have infinite sources. In the case of interference, how many sources do you have? Actually, you have only 2 sources, right? So ideally speaking, we have only 2 sources. Assuming that it's almost like a point source. Okay? In reality, it's not true because that single double slit also have got some width to it, which means within this width you have very fine diffraction pattern going on. Okay? Are you following what I'm saying? Okay, we'll come back to that later. Let's finish this off. So if I take this as a center point, right? So now if for reasoning out, right? So depending upon the situation, we'll be taking different points. So if I take this point and this point, right? So both will be having 0 path difference. If I take this point and this point, right? So let me see. Yeah, so for reasoning out purpose, so sometimes we change the lining this way. So I would take this as 1 dash, this as 2 dash. That means 1 and 1 dash will be having path difference 0. 2 and 2 dash will be having path difference 0. 3 and 3 dash will be having path difference 0. So that's what you are supposed to write. So 1 and 1 dash will have a path difference 0. 2 and 2 dash will have a path difference 0. So when path difference is 0, is it constructive or destructive? It is constructive. That means, so it is constructive. Interference, right? So don't get confused with the word interference, even though we are talking about diffraction, right? These two waves are interfering together or coming together. Constructive interference. Giving rise to central bright fringe. Okay. So depending upon the question, if they ask you to explain dark fringe from diffraction pattern, you have to explain that one. If they ask you to explain how central bright fringe is formed, then you have to explain this one. So make a drawing like this and then you have to explain this. So we have seen dark fringe, we have seen central bright fringe. So what is left? Bright fringe, right? The regular bright fringe. Because this is applicable only for central bright fringe. Okay. So again, this is not the usual way, you know, this is not the way we have done for interference. The interference reasoning was much different. Whereas in the case of diffraction, right, we have infinite sources. So because of the infinite sources, the same method of explaining will not work. There you had only two sources. Here we have so many number of sources, infinite sources. So which means we are adopting a different method. Okay. Can I erase this side? Anybody still copying? So as I've been telling you from the beginning, it's not an easy topic, okay? So make sure you are studying it right from the beginning. So I hope you already studied the first two parts properly. So this is the third part, and then you have polarization, then you have resolution, then you have Doppler effect. So you have three more parts coming up. Okay, so let's say again, we are talking about bright fringe now. So let me make it a little more bigger. So this is my slit width A. So now when we are trying to explain the bright fringe, instead of dividing it into two, we will be dividing it into three. Okay. Suppose if I divide this part as three parts, this would be called as A by 3, this length. This is A by 3. This is A by 3. As I said, you know, if you are still wondering why are we following so much of a complicated method, the reason is you have infinite sources. So the interference method will not work here. So suppose if I consider the same thing, let's talk about power. Bright fringe. So again, we are considering some point here P. So let's say it's going from here to here. So diagram is going to be very simple. If you understood the first part, this is also going to be very similar. So what makes a difference? This and this are pretty much the same. So the only difference is caused by path difference, right? That means this is my path difference. So this is theta. This is A by 3, A by 3, A by 3. And this is, the entire thing is A. So we said this, if this is A and this is theta, this must be A sine theta. No doubt in it. Right? So there we took it as n lambda. So here I am going to take it as 2n plus 1 lambda by 2. Or to make it simpler, let me take it as 3 lambda by 2. Okay. So what I am saying here is, if this is 3 lambda by 2, right? So for an instant, let's assume that if this is 3 lambda by 2, what can you say about this length? This big triangle and this small triangle are similar triangles, right? If this is A by 3, this should also be this by 3. Do you agree? So that means this is 3 lambda by 2 divided by 3. So 3, 3 cancels. So which means this will be lambda by 2. Why 3 lambda by 2? Because we are trying to explain the first bright fringe. We will, you know, generalize it after this. Okay. So first we are talking about the first bright fringe, which will happen only at 3 lambda by 2. So the lambda by 2 will not be there. We will talk about that. I will show you. Okay. It's a bit different from the interference. Or let's take it as, if I take this path difference as lambda by 2, what will happen there? That's a question we are trying to answer, right? So So let's assume that if this is 3 lambda by 2, what will happen there? Will it be constructive or destructive? That's the answer we are going to answer. Okay. I mean, that's the question we are trying to answer. So this is 3 lambda by 2, this is lambda by 2. So if I the line here, so this is lambda by 2, this is 3 lambda by 2. What can you say about this one? Simply lambda, right? So this is 1 by 2, this is 1.5. That means this must be 1. So it will be lambda. Okay. So this will be 3 lambda by 2. Everyone okay with this? So if you are okay with this, all the others are very simple. So now go back to the same logic which we have been using. So let's say this is 1, 2, 3 infinite sources here. This is, let's say there are some corresponding sources here. 1 dash, 2 dash, 3 dash. This is 1 double dash, 2 double dash, 3 double dash, right? So now tell me carefully, answer this question. If I have this 1 and this 1 dash, let's say the waves are going here and then going there. So the path difference between this and this is lambda by 2. So will it be constructive or destructive? It will be destructive, right? So whenever it is lambda by 2, it's going to be destructive. That's what we saw in the previous one, right? So that means from the first part, 1 and 1 dash will interfere at P, destructively. So 2 and 2 dash will interfere at P destructively. Why? Because if you reduce the length a little bit this way, the same thing you have to do it for this side, which means again the path difference will be lambda by 2, which means that will lead to interfere at P destructively. That means, what can I say? This part and this part are going to destructively interfere, right? So all the light from here and all the light from here is going to destructively interfere, which means it's not going to give you any light there, right? So that's the beauty of this wave topics, right? So light plus light becomes darkness, right? So either light plus light can become brighter or it can become darker, right? Which is not possible if it was particles, right? So that's why this is one of the important topics where it's establishing the importance of wave nature of light. Okay, so if I say this is first part and this is second part, first part and second part interfere destructively at P. So if these two parts are kind of cancelling each other, what is left? What is left? The third part is left. So that means this and this are going to cancel each other, but then there is some more light coming from this part, right? But then now the point is, earlier, let's say in the central bright fringe, all these parts were contributing for the bright fringe over here. But now what happens? This part is kind of removed. It's not going to contribute for the light over there because it is already cancelled out. So the only part which is contributing for the light here is only this part. So only 1/3 is contributing for the light at P. Do you agree? So that's an important point to understand. So only the third part.
Two single dash.
Two single dash. Yeah, you are right. So only third part of the slit, which is 1 double dash, 2 double dash, 3 double dash, contribute for the light at P. However, this is only 1/3 of the total slit width A by 3. Do you agree? So since only 1/3 of the slit is contributing for the light over there, right, we can say the amplitude is going to be only 1/3, right? So when you have two waves with same A, A plus A becomes 2A. But what happens to the intensity? Intensity is proportional to amplitude square. That means 2A becomes 4A squared. So it becomes 4 times the original amplitude, right? I'm sorry, the original wave. Remember that? So the intensity actually squares. So that means the amplitude over here, right? The amplitude at P is only 1/3 of the original. So if the amplitude is only 1/3, what can you say about the intensity? Intensity is going to be 1 by 3 the whole squared, which means 1 by 9. So that means the intensity is going to be, so now does it make sense why this one was looking like this and this one was looking only like this? So it's almost 10 times lower. 1/9 means almost 10 times lower. Okay. So the amplitude at P is only 1/3 of the original slit. Original total amplitude. So the intensity is only 1/9 of the original original bright fringe. Okay, they may ask you a question, why the secondary maximas in diffraction pattern reduces in intensity. This is the answer you are supposed to explain. So depending upon the question, you are supposed to explain this. Okay, and take down this diagram also. So this is like, first n is equal to 1, so E lambda by 2, first intensity is only 1/9 of the bright fringe. Because only 1/3 of the slit is contributing for the light. So only 1/3 is contributing for the light over there, which means the intensity is decreased. So the same explanation can be extended for next one. So here, so think about it. From here it reduced this much, right? The intensity was decreased so much. And the next one, if you see that, it will be much more lower, right? So it will be something like this. So this is n is equal to 2. So the way we explain the second one is, it's just an extension of this one. Any doubts here? Anybody having any doubts? Only if you understood this, you can go to the next one.
Both are slit width A only.
However, this is only 1/3 of the total slip width. Yeah. So I meant the actual value is a by 3. Okay, so if you understood this, following the same, so if it's asked in the exam, probably, you know, if you explain this first part carefully, then that is sufficient. Maybe the second part, you can just quickly say that following the same methodology, you can say that. Following the same methodology. We can say for n is equal to 2 maxima, secondary maxima. So I'm not going to do the entire drawing. So since you understood that, I can say that it's going to be something like this, right? And instead of 3 lambda by 2, I'm going to say this is 5 lambda by 2. Okay. So again, if that was 3 lambda by 2, that will be giving the first order maximum. If this is 5 lambda by 2, then it will be giving me the second maximum, which how we'll be talking about that. So suppose if I, there we divided the slit into 3 parts. So here we are going to divide it by 5 parts, right? So very simple. So you understood this, it's very simple. So let's say 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So after that it's the same story, so nothing very different. So if this is 5 lambda by 2, this is going to be lambda by 2, and if this is a, this is going to be a by 5. Okay, so I don't think you have to explain all these things, but if I understood that, I think this is sufficient. Okay, so what will be the explanation here? This part, right, 1 and 1 dash will be having a path difference of lambda by 2, which means they will be constructive or destructive? Destructive. What can you say about the 1 double dash and 1 triple dash here? These two will be again having lambda by 2 difference, which means they will be destructively interfering. So what is left? Only 1/5 of the slit. Are you following that? It's the same methodology. So I'm saying that we had only 2 parts cancelling each other. Here we are saying this and this cancel each other, and this will cancel each other, which means only part which is left is only 1/5. That means only 1/5 of the slit width will contribute for the light. So amplitude will be a by 5. So intensity will be 1/25, 1/25 of the central bright fringe. So it's a very often asked question, okay? So they will ask you some theoretical explanation. So make sure you know how to explain this. So that means intensity here is 1/9. Here it is 1/25. What will be the next one? 3/5, 1/49, right? 3/5, 7. So 1/7 will be 1/49. So that means it will be the next one will be, so write it down. So this will be 1/49 intensity. So this is 1/25 intensity. 1/9. And this you take it as 1. Well, that's the comparison, right? So when I say 1/9, 1/25, we are talking about compared to this one, this intensity. Any doubts so far? If you have any doubts, please stop me. It's not an easy one. If you have doubts, you have to clarify it immediately. If you keep your doubts to yourself, you are going to be struggling later on. Okay, one thing I missed to do is, just like the previous dark fringe, right? Again, we are talking about bright fringe, secondary bright fringes. So, what are we supposed to say? If this is A, this will be A sin theta. If this is A by 3, what can you say about this one? A by 3? Sin theta. So, that means I can say that.
Should I write it?
Okay. So, I think I'll write it here. So, A by 3 sin theta is equal to lambda by 2. Do you agree? So, if I say theta is very small, then it will be A theta is equal to 3 lambda by 2. That means theta is equal to 3 lambda by 2 divided by A. Okay. So, this is for your first maxima. That means you will be giving the generalized formula will be, so similarly you will be getting theta is equal to 5 by 2 lambda by A. Right. So, just make a dot dot. So, if you put a dot dot, it means follow the same methodology. So, generalized. So, by generalization, I can say theta is equal to 2n plus 1 lambda by 2, then divide by A. So, if you go back to your interference, right, did we use 2n minus 1 or 2n plus 1? Minus 1. Here we are using 2n plus 1. Any idea why? Let me check one more time in your book if they are using the same thing, because I don't want to contradict your book. Our book, as usual, nothing is there, right? So, only the theoretical explanation is there, all the formulas and nothing, everything is hidden inside. Yeah, I think they are using plus,
2n plus 1.
Usually when you have this, right, 3 by 2 lambda, 5 by 2 lambda, all these things, right? The first one should be lambda by 2, right? So, but where is the lambda by 2? It's actually missing, right? So, in the diffraction pattern, what happens is the first one actually occupies more distance, which means the lambda by 2 is actually occupied. So, the first one itself will be 3 lambda by 2. Okay? So, this will be, what is this? Minima. Minima will be 1 lambda, right? So, lambda by A. That's what you study in the dark fringe. So, this will be lambda by A, this will be 1, so this will be 1.5, so that means lambda by 2 is somewhere here, which is already occupied by the bright fringe, central bright fringe. Okay, so that's the reason why it looks a little bit different, right? So, you should start n is equal to 1, 2, 3, so something like that. Okay, so as a continuation of this, right, so we didn't do the linear location here, right? In the case of interference pattern, right? If you remember n lambda d by d, remember that? So that is your linear location. But here we are directly deriving the theta. This is your angular location, right? But then the difference between angular location and linear location is only capital D, right? If I put a capital D, I will get the linear location, right? So, let us summarize all the formulas here so that it's easy for you to understand. So, I'm going to erase that side. Anybody still copying this one? So, we are talking about diffraction again, right? So, you have bright fringe, then you have dark fringe. Okay. So, in the dark fringe, we derived it as theta n is equal to n lambda by A. Right, this is what we derived. here we derived it as theta n is equal to, here you have to, you are supposed to write a small n here. So theta n is equal to 2n plus 1 lambda by a. Instead of n you have 2n plus 1 by 2. So as I told you, if you want the linear location, xn will be n lambda d by a. So simply multiply by d from your interference knowledge, right? So if you are wondering how I got that, it's very simple. So you see, this is my theta, this is my xn, right? This is my capital D, right? If theta is very small, it can be, tan theta can be approximated as theta. So tan theta is equal to opposite by adjacent, right? So xn by d. So xn by d, so the d goes on the other side, so we'll get this. Okay, so it's very simple. So similarly, I can say xn is equal to 2n plus 1 by 2 lambda by a into d. Then we studied something called fringe width beta. So here we are, even though we didn't study that, right, derive that, you can follow the same logic and you'll get the same answer. So lambda d by d, so nothing different, right? Whatever you got for interference is the same thing here. Also it will be beta lambda d by d. However, there is one exception. Remember I told you, if I put dark fringe 1, right? So if I put the dark fringe 1, this will be lambda d by a. So this point will be lambda d by a. So carefully listen everyone, on this side will also be lambda d by a. So that means from 0, this is lambda d by a, this is lambda d by a. So what can you say about the total fringe width of the 2 lambda d by a, which is not true for other cases, right? For all the other things it is lambda d by, did I make a mistake here? It's not small d, right? It's a. So in the interference we have been using small d, here you are supposed to use small a. So for central bright fringe alone, right? So for central bright fringe, say exception, so it will be beta is equal to 2 lambda d by a. Okay, so I think we have covered everything, whatever. What is the angular width? You simply remove the n and you will get lambda by a. That is your angular width. Right. So if you want, you can write that angular width theta width is going to be lambda by a. Just like what you do here, if you remove the n, you will get this one. So here also, but for central bright fringe, what will be the same? 2 times, right? So it will be 2 times lambda by a. And some books may confuse you, right? So some books will take this as lambda. So some books will take this as lambda width. That's what I have been following. So this point and this point. So this difference is called lambda width. And some books may take, okay, so in this case, in the central bright fringe, this is a central bright fringe like this. So this is my theta with central bright fringe. So in that case, I will say theta 2 times lambda. Yeah. Okay, so we have finished part 3, so I think we have two more parts, two or three parts.